Welcome to the 112th episode of the Reading and Writing Podcast. I'm your host, Jeff Rutherford. Stay tuned for my interview with Paul Witcover, a fantasy and science fiction author and the author of the new novel, Emperor of All Things. Stay tuned for the interview. Welcome back to the Reading and Writing Podcast. My guest today is Paul Witcover. Paul's latest novel is The Emperor of All Things. Paul's earlier novels include Waking Beauty, Tumbling After, and Asylum. Paul, welcome to the podcast.
Thanks, Jeff.
Sure. Well, I wondered, as we get started, if you could just read the first page or two of your new novel, Emperor of All Things.
I'd be glad to. I'm going to read, I guess, the first page and a half or so, which is the prologue, sort of sets the scene a little bit. Clocks. Clocks everywhere, on the wooden shelves and tables, even upon the sawdust-covered floor of the attic room. Clocks of all shapes and sizes limned in the light of a gibbous moon that did not so much pierce the skylight as sift through its sooty glass. Tall clocks in finely carved and polished casings of exotic woods with brass pendulums winking back and forth, ornate mantel clocks of ormolu and mahogany, marble and tortoiseshell, clocks of gold and silver set into or alongside precious metal and porcelain renderings of human figures in various states of dress and undress, as well as representations of beasts real and fabulous, lions consorting with unicorns, eagles and griffins roosting side by side, cuckoo clocks and carriage clocks, and tambour clocks and skeleton clocks, even pocket watches with their chains and ribbons neatly coiled or dangling free and loose as slipped lanyards. The ticking of so many timepieces, no two synchronized, filled the space with a facsimile of whispered conversation, as if some ghostly parliament were meeting in the dead of night. Scattered among the clocks were glass flasks and vials of assorted shapes and sizes, some containing clear or opaque liquids, others quite empty, along with mortars and pestles, iron tongs, funnels, crucibles, and other such instruments bespeaking the practice of alchemy. Set in a row along one wall were three brick furnaces, one in the shape of a tower and as tall as a man, the other two smaller and squat in shape like ornamental toads. A mouse was making its way across the surface of one table, nosing amid a clutter of clock parts and tools, pins, clicks, rivets, coiled springs, tweezers, clamps, winders, files, and like essentials of the horologist's trade. Every so often it rose off its tiny front paws to sniff the air, whiskers twitching, eyes aglitter like apple seeds in a bed of ash. From a shelf overhead, a black cat followed its progress with glowing tourmaline eyes. The noise in the back of its throat, somewhere between a growl and a purr, was cloaked by the gossipy muttering of the clocks. The tip of its tail lashed from side to side like a metronome. When the meanderings of the mouse brought it conveniently near, the cat moved with the grace of a gliding shadow, seeming as insubstantial, until it struck. In leaping to the tabletop, it did not disturb a single item, yet knocked the rodent onto its side, pressing the half-stunned creature down with one paw and slashing with its teeth at the gray fur. The cat tensed and flattened at a sound from overhead. A faint click followed by a drawn-out creaking, as if the old house were settling on its foundations. Hissing, the cat darted a glance upwards as a thin rope dropped through the now open skylight to dangle above the floor, a few feet away. The rope had not reached the end of its length before the cat bolted, with less stealth or silence than just moments before, small gears and other items scattered under its paws as it fled into the shadows. An empty vial slipped to the floor and shattered. The mouse was long gone. Drops of its blood glistened on the table, dark as oil. A svelte figure slid down the rope and dropped soundlessly to the floor. The intruder was dressed in gray, soft gray boots, gray breeches, a gray shirt beneath a gray cloak. Strapped to its back was a small crossbow, and a blade as slender as a rapier, yet no longer than a short sword, hung in a gray scabbard from its belt, as did six leather pouches, also gray. A gray kerchief pulled across the nose hid the bottom half of the face. A gray hood cloaked the upper. In between, Eyes as dark as the mouse's glittered as they probed the shadowy corners of the room. The intruder strode to one of the tables. The timepieces on this particular table were clearly the work of master craftsmen. Many were made with precious metals. Not a few were inset with jewels. A single one of these clocks, selected at random, would have made a rich prize for a thief. Yet the gray-clad figure reached without hesitation for a mantle clock that appeared as out of place as an ordinary goblet set alongside the Holy Grail. At a whisper of displaced air, the intruder turned, clock in one hand, the rapier-like blade in the other. And I'll stop there.
Okay, great. Well, if the listeners haven't read your new novel yet, how would you describe The Emperor of All Things?
Well, I can fortunately read you from the cover copy.
Okay.
This saves me the difficulty of having to come up to with an answer for that difficult question, which is the bane of all writers. The cover copy says, 1758, the age of enlightenment, yet the advance of reason has not brought peace. England is embroiled in a war that stretches from her North American colonies to Europe and beyond. Across the channel, the French prepare to invade. Daniel Quare is a journeyman of the Worshipful Company of Clockmakers. He is also a regulator, member of a secret order within the guild tasked with seeking out horological innovations that could give England the upper hand over her enemies. Now Quare's superiors have heard tell of a singular device, a pocket watch rumored to possess properties that have more to do with magic than with any known science. But Quare soon learns that he is not alone in searching for this strange and sinister timepiece. He is pursued by a French spy who will stop at nothing to fetch the prize back to his masters, and a mysterious thief known only as Grimalkin seeks the watch as well for purposes equally enigmatic. Daniel's path is full of adventure, intrigue, betrayal, and murder, and it will lead him from the world he knows to an otherwhere of demigods and dragons in which nothing is as it seems, time least of all.
Great. Well, do you remember what gave you kind of the original idea or inspiration for the novel?
I vaguely do. I say vaguely because this is a book whose origins go back over 20 years to a story that I wrote in the early 1980s, shortly after I came back from or graduated from the Clarion Writers Workshop. So it must have been like 82 or 83. Anyway, I had this idea or image really that I built kind of a really bad short story around of a tower clock in a kind of a European town in the anytime from the Middle Ages through maybe the Reformation, and the kind of strange figures that came out of the tower clock, the automatons. And I did some research on clocks and went to a few clock museums and wrote a story which was really kind of beyond my abilities at the time. But I always remembered the images that had fired up that story in the first place. And finally, a few years ago, I was after my last book, in fact, I was kind of thinking of what I was going to write next. And I felt like it was finally time for me to come back to that idea.
Interesting. So what was the, you said you had done some research about watches and clocks. Had you always been interested in them, or did you just decide to research it for the story and then the novel?
Yeah, it just kind of grew out of the image I had of this clock tower and its automatons that I mentioned to you. And understanding how to write about them in an authentic way just sort of led me into doing a lot of research. And I'm still doing that, doing a lot of research today, even as I work on the next book. This is a 2-book series, so I'm finishing it up right now.
Great. And as you explained to me before we started recording, currently the novel is available in the UK, but you haven't had a US sale yet. I'm assuming that that your agent has submitted it in the US.
We've submitted it in certain places, but we haven't submitted it widely. Mm-hmm. And at this point, because the British edition is coming out so soon, on Valentine's Day, in fact, we're basically holding off, and we're just going to see how it does in England, I think.
Gotcha. And if someone's listening to this in the U.S., I'm assuming that they could, you know, I'm assuming they could order the ebook via Amazon, even though they're in the U.S.
Yes. And I mean, they can order the hardcover as well through Amazon UK if they want. But as you point out, the ebook is also available.
Gotcha. So you mentioned earlier, Clarion, kind of two questions around that. First, I was just curious, what was like your original desire or passion to write? Was that something that was always there, or was there a specific time that you started writing short stories or novels when you were a kid? What age were you?
Well, I guess I both of my parents were involved in literature, I guess you would say, or writing. My dad's a journalist. My mom was an English teacher. And so I grew up, you know, in a household where reading was encouraged and writers were looked on with respect. And, you know, my dad, as a journalist, worked from home a lot. And I grew up with the noise of a typewriter kind of in the background, and also with an awareness of the discipline that a writer needs to have. And when I started becoming, I guess, interested in writing as opposed to just reading, which was probably when I was in around fifth grade or so, I was really interested in being a poet. And it probably wasn't until I got to college that I realized my interests or talents lay more in the realm of fiction. And, you know, because what I was really interested in, what I really loved to read was science fiction and fantasy. That was around the same time as writers like Samuel Delaney and Michael Moorcock and Brian Aldiss were, you know, and J.G. Ballard were really making a big splash. I mean, I was a little late to all of that, obviously, but I mean, to me, discovering those writers really opened my eyes to the possibilities that were inherent in the literature of the fantastic. And I guess I never really looked back. I felt like they gave me permission to do what I love to do.
Gotcha. And what age were you when you did the Clarion workshop?
I was 21, just out of college.
And what was that experience like? I've heard that it can be intense for some people.
Yeah, it was very intense. I mean, I really had no notion of what to expect. I was there with some super talented people who have gone on to successful careers. Lucia Shepherd was one of my classmates there, and Mikey Rosner Herman. I don't know. For me, it was a really necessary, beneficial kind of kick in the pants, you know, because I had a very inflated view of my talent and my abilities and where I was in my development as a writer. And I mean, it did not take long in that environment to realize that I had a lot to learn, and I had good people to learn it from there.
And who are some of your instructors?
Well, Damon Knight and Kate Wilhelm were still teaching then. Algis Budrius was one of my teachers, and he was fantastic, actually. He probably helped me more than anyone else to recognize my own authentic voice as a writer. And it was something I actually would never have recognized if he hadn't pointed it out to me. Kit Reed was one of my teachers, also really good. I'm friends with her to this day.
I'm curious what you just said about AJ Boutrous and pointing out your kind of natural voice. Do you remember what he said to you or
yeah, what yeah, sure it? I do. Sure I do. I mean, you know, at Clarion, one of the things that's stressed is producing a lot of stories. And I mentioned just a moment ago that, you know, my understanding of the possibilities of fantastic literature were, you know, very much awakened by reading, you know, writers like Delaney and Moorcock and so on. And Delaney especially was a really big influence for me. And one of the great things that Boutrous did in that class was pointed out to me my thraldom to the style of Delaney. He at one point critiquing one of my stories, he called me Samuel R. Witcover. So I got the message, you know, but I didn't know from that what I knew what not to do, but I didn't know what to do. And then later, one of my fellow students, Mario Milosevic, and I collaborated on a story. And there was a line in that story. I don't remember the exact line right now, but it was what I considered to be a very stripped down and sort of plain spoken line. And Boutrous pointed to that as, you know, that is you speaking or you writing in your unique, appropriate voice. And because he was right, it resonated with me. You know, I didn't look at it and say, you're crazy. I looked at it and said, oh, of course, now I recognize that, you know, the feeling I had while I was writing that sentence was the feeling of encountering my own voice.
Interesting. And so you went and did more of that?
I tried to. I mean, you know, it was a struggle and an enduring struggle. You know, continuing one to first of all recognize that voice and then be faithful to it and not let it be corrupted by, you know, whatever is out there. The success of selling a story, that could be a bad thing. You know, the reading what the reviewers have to say, reading other writers that I admire. You know, there's a lot of things that are both that both feed and make a writer stronger. And then there's a lot of things that can, you know, sort of corrupt what a writer has that's uniquely his or her own.
Sure. So what was the path to publication like for you for your first novel, Waking Beauty, from, you know, your experience at Clarion and then, you know, working on that novel and eventually getting it published? Were there other novels before Waking Beauty?
Not really. I wrote a novel in college for my for the honors program there, but it was a pretty crappy novel. And after I got back from Clarion, I sold a couple of stories, but I felt like I was not really growing as a writer. I wasn't having a lot of successes. As time went by, I got more and more blocked. And finally, I decided I would go back to school and got a master's degree in English and writing. And it was during that period that I started work on what became Waking Beauty. And it was a book that just sort of came out of nowhere and really sort of took me over. And I wasn't really aware of everything I was doing in that book. I was not in command or control of my tools, and nonetheless, something that I'm still very proud of managed to get done. And I already had an agent, luckily, due to a friend of mine who introduced me to Ralph Vicinanza, who was a wonderful person and a great agent, very supportive of my work, even though I was the smallest fish in his pond. And he ultimately passed me on to my my current agent, who I'm very, very happy with. And anyway, my current agent actually turned out to be the editor of my first book. So it's all in the family.
Well, I know you're a big reader of science fiction and fantasy, and you've been a book reviewer for Locust Magazine. Given the amount of reading that you do, are there any particular trends that you're noticing in science fiction and fantasy now or in the last, 5 to 10 years?
Well, just speaking in really broad terms, I think that the most interesting thing that I've seen is the willingness on the part of the best writers in our genre, both science fiction and fantasy, to just not think of themselves in exclusively genre terms anymore. And basically, they look for their subjects, they look for their influences wherever, and they incorporate all kinds of stuff into their work. Some of that turns out to have a wider appeal than the purely genre audience, and some doesn't. But I think it's interesting, and it demonstrates the degree to which genre is really a kind of a publishing creation. I don't think that's entirely true, but there's some truth to that.
Sure. And what books or authors have you read in the past couple of years that really stood out for you that made an impact and that you would recommend?
Wow. Well, I've actually stopped reviewing. I stopped reviewing about a year ago, and then last year I was a judge for the Philip K. Dick Awards, and I just finished a lot of intensive reading for that. So my response to all of that has been to immediately forget everything that I've read. Okay. But I can mention a couple of authors. I mean, I think Catherine Valente is just a fabulous writer in every sense of that word, and I admire her work so much, and she is a genuine original, super talented. I think I've been reading a writer named Felix Gilman, who has about, I guess his fourth book has just been published, and he's also quite extraordinary, a fantasy writer with sort of slipstreamy elements.
You're the second interviewee in a row that's mentioned Felix Gilman.
Uh-huh. Yeah, he's really good. He lives here in New York. I think he might even live in Brooklyn. But a very original writer, a literary writer, but I don't hold that against him, and nobody else should either. Let's see, who else? Robert Reddick, who's a fantasy, more of a traditional fantasy, epic fantasy writer, but he just finished a four-book series, The Chatharin Voyages, that are just awesome. I mean, they take so many of those old epic fantasy tropes and really, really work with them in a new way. So a lot to admire there. Let's see if I can think of any people on the science fiction side that you wouldn't necessarily know. Well, actually, some of the books that I just read for the Philip K. Dick Award, although we haven't announced the winners yet, so I'm not at liberty to say anything about the short list of that was just released, and really every book on that short list is an amazing book. I thought they were so strong. The book called Lost Everything by Brian Francis Slattery, a book called The Not Yet by Moira Crone, a really strange, odd book called Love Seed. I can't remember the author's name. A book called Harmony. Just some really interesting, innovative science fiction. So anybody listening to this that's interested should just do a search for the Philip K. Dick Award this year, the 2012, and check out that short list. I guarantee you'll find more than one interesting book on there.
Great. Well, obviously, ebooks and the ability to easily self-publish has had a huge impact on book publishing since the launch of the Kindle in 2007. Do you spend much time thinking about the impact of ebooks on publishing?
No, I don't. But I do use a Kindle a lot.
Have you thought about self-publishing any of your like older stories or doing a collection of short stories?
Well, in fact, I am going to be publishing an ebook version, a revised ebook version of my first novel, Waking Beauty.
Great. When should we look for that? Later this year? Or?
Yeah, it would probably be later this year. I was just going to basically turn it into an ebook, but once I started looking at it, I mean, it's the first time I've actually read the book since I wrote it. And I realized that I had cut some things for when I published it that I really felt I could justify putting back in there if I expanded the book a little bit. So that's what I'm doing. And, I'm working, like I said, I'm working on the sequel to The Emperor of All Things. That's my primary concern right now, but I'm trying to fit this project in at the same time.
Sure. Well, I was curious about your writing process. Do you have a specific workflow and do you feel like you're more of an organic writer or do you do a lot of extensive outlining when you're working on a novel?
Absolutely not. No, I am an organic writer. I'm very rigid in terms of, budgeting my time and working every day. Usually I try to get up pretty early in the morning and put in a few hours. I earn a living as a freelance writer and editor. So the rest of the day is pretty much taken up with my, projects that are actually paying the rent. But I if I can get a few hours in the morning under my belt, then I feel like, that's my day right there. And everything else is just sort of, gravy after that. I will occasionally, sketch out a scene, maybe even a few scenes ahead of where I am currently in a book. And usually I kind of have an idea of where I'm going and where I'm going to end up. But I don't know exactly how I'm going to get there. And usually I find that, if I go and I'm a fairly slow writer, I revise as I go. I find that, if I pay attention to what's going on every day, the book will slowly kind of reveal itself to me and it will tell me where to go next. And, if I make a mistake and try to impose my own will or desires on the book, sooner or later I'll get stuck. And that's always a signal to me that I need to rethink or re-listen to what the book is trying to tell me.
Interesting. So have you developed any kind of tips or tricks over the, over the years of writing that if you do sit down for that 2 hours a day and it's just not working what do you do in that situation? Do you stay with a novel or do you, maybe pull up a short story and work on it? What's your kind of process?
I basically just beat my head against the wall, until I break through.
Gotcha. So what advice do you have for aspiring writers who may be listening, who would like to, have their, short stories and novels published?
I think it's important to read a lot and read really widely, not just in the genre and not just fiction. Read people that know what they're doing, and try to understand how they're doing what they're doing. I mean, one of the things that you learn as a writer is that the kind of naive pleasure that you once took in reading is just gone, never to return. And partly that's, you can't help but feel a little disappointed in that. But on the other hand, it makes for a very different and kind of more involved and self-critical way of reading, where you're interrogating the text in front of you on a number of different levels, and you can really, really learn a lot that way. And you know, I think workshops can be helpful. I teach at the Gotham Writing Workshop, which is an online workshop. And I teach at a university as well. So and both of those teaching gigs are structured around the workshop experiences. I learned it at Clarion. So I do think that like workshops can sort of be a shortcut in the writing process if you're a dedicated enough writer in the first place.
Great. So where can people find you online?
Well, I do have a web page, but I don't really keep it up. I'm actually kind of in preliminary discussions about getting somebody to revamp that for me. So it really would be useless for me to even give that out. Okay. I'm on Facebook. I used to have a blog called The Inferior 4+1, where I was blogging with other writers, Paul DiFilippo and Elizabeth Hand and Lucia Shepherd. I found that was a little bit too, I did it for about 2 or 3 years. And then I found that it wasn't as much fun anymore. It was starting to become like a duty or a burden or something. So I set it down.
Right. Right. Well, great. Well, again, we've been speaking with Paul Witcover. His latest novel is The Emperor of All Things. Available now from Bantam in the UK. And as he said earlier, he's working on the second book in that series. Paul, thanks for doing the interview.
Thanks so much, Jeff.